We are live now. Very good evening to all of you. This is in the series of Facebook Live Challenge. Today we have with us Dr. Vinit Gupta, sir. He is Honorary Secretary of the Anesthetic Society, and he has done certificate course in medicine and law and advanced certificate course in NABH. We attended his lecture, Patient Consent and Facts and Myths. It was a wonderful presentation. You can watch it even now. It is available on Facebook as well as on YouTube. So we are going to hear from Vinit Gupta, sir, on Patient Consent, Facts and Myths, Part 2. Please, sir.
Hello. Good evening, friends. Thank you very much, Dr. Hetal and TAS. So, most of you must have attended the part one also about the patient consent, facts and myths. So, this time we are talking about the further part two. For the new joinee who have not attended the part one, I would like to explain the first slide. Why this slide was put in the start of the discussion. The person standing is a doctor. In the waterfall, you can see, and water around is the adversity which is actually there around any doctor. This rainbow show means the illusion of self-knowledge, or you can say a doctor's understanding of law. This is simply an illusion. Getting wet is actually the reality which happens when adversity acts against the doctor. And this man is wearing a raincoat. The raincoat is diligent professional training, qualification, patient care, and documentation. The most vital part of the documentation is patient consent. So let's move for the part two. So what should be recorded in a consent? So as I told you all in part one also, these medico-legal consultations or discussion are actually to be presented word to word. So you may be finding that I'll be speaking every word of this presentation, but it is must, because every word carries the legal, can say, validity. So, and we should not miss in a single form or word from this valid documents. So what is to be recorded in the consent is correct scientific name of the proposed or consented therapy or intervention or anesthesia, nature and purpose of the proposed consent therapy or intervention, inherent and special risks, probability of success, time required for the recovery, any alternative method and its associated risk and benefit, risk and prognosis if no treatment is rendered or intervention is performed, date and time when the treatment will commence or intervention will be performed, signature of the patient and doctor, signature of witness if required, and then advisable are name and counter signature of the hospital staff, doctor, nurse who take patient signature or consent. Then date and time when the consent is signed. Consultant surgeon for a specific period or only for a procedure or surgery. It is very common fact nowadays that few of the surgeons, even the anesthetists, they are coming for a specific procedure as a visiting doctor to the hospital. They are actually not the routine staff of the doctor, the hospital. And sometimes some specific surgery has to be performed by some specialist surgeon who are not part of the hospital, and they are called from another hospital or if, as a freelancing surgeon. So this is about them. So disclose to the patient and record in the consent form if a consultant surgeon has came only for a specific period or only for a specific purpose. consultation, intervention, and thereafter the patient will be taken care of by the other doctor or designated doctor. This also should be disclosed to the patient and is to be taken in the written consent form. So I will be mentioning two cases. In first case, the patient has undergone IVF procedure and the doctor left for some family function next day. The patient developed some problems and she was admitted to the hospital, and later that patient sued the doctor. The court held the hospital negligent, because the consequences could have been different if the patient was informed about the absence beforehand. This was court's advisory to the doctors, that if you have the program to go out or if you are here for a short period, you should always explain these things to the patient. In the second case, the patient underwent surgery at a hospital. The surgeon who performed the surgery had came from another city and left the patient immediately after the surgery. The court expressed the displeasure as the surgeon has left the patient within half an hour of the performing of the surgery. Here also, court said that this fact should be explained to the patient beforehand. Then taking consent step by step. First, ascertain whether the patient has the capacity to give the consent. Provide relevant information to the patient necessary to take an informed decision. Communicate in the language understood by the patient. Take signature of a witness in case the consent form is in language not known to the patient. It happens many times that most of our consent forms are either written in English or Hindi or some regional language, but patients are illiterate and they cannot read and write. In that case, it is very important to have a witness who can really tell them about the procedure and who can sign the consent as a witness. Give the patient enough time to give consent after counseling, especially for the sensitive procedures. Record specifically in the consent the date and time when the patient's consent was sought and when the patient gave consent. This is very important. Sometimes when you counsel a patient is not in the mood of giving consent. They want to give a second thought. They want to talk to their family doctors, relatives, or give them enough time to discuss in themselves and then take the consent. Consent should not be a formality, just have a signature on blank paper. No. Take written consent signed by the patient. Take identification proof of the patient, attendant signing consent. Match the signature. This is also very important. Patient files and auditing of the files, the most important, most important, it is very important part is patient's ID card, ID proofs. The patient's ID proofs are needed just not for the identification of the patient. The other part is usual ID proofs have their signature or thumb impression, which can be matched with their consent signature. If their signature are not matching, tell them to sign exactly the same way it is signed on their ID proof, like the banks do. So again, I will cite two more cases. In one case, this patient and her husband approached to the gynecologist to perform NTP and tubal ligation. The surgery was done successfully. Later on, patient sued the doctor as well as husband that this was done without her consent. The gynecologist pointed out in the court in her defense that it is not the fact. We have called both husband and wife twice, and in fact wife alone once, and it was expressed and explained everything, and patients as well as her husband has signed the consent. Court even refused to accept this, admit the complaint. In second case, the patient underwent surgery whereby his sinus was duly excised and the left testis was also removed. But the removal of the testis consent was not taken. In that case, court held the doctor negligent. Then precautions in filling the consent form. Avoid the alteration, addition, or eraser while filing the consent form. Additional pages, documents attached with the consent form. Always number all the pages, documents, and the consent form serially. The printed consent form must be numbered 1. Take patient signature on each and every page. Take the patient signature initials wherever handwritten typed entries are done, especially where risks are enumerated, corrections or new sentences have been added. Fill completely or carefully. Do not leave any space blank in printed consent form. Strike out the blank spaces. Record specifically patient's delay in giving consent. This is also very important in the consent form. Record specifically the date and time when the patient consent was sought and when the patient gave consent. Because sometimes in critical conditions, the time is very important. If patient has delayed the consent, probably his or her prognosis is affected. So we must enter this into the consent form. Again, two more cases I'll cite. In one case, the patient underwent surgery and her left adrenal gland and left kidney were removed. The patient expired about 2 months after the surgery. One of the allegations was that no consent was obtained before the surgery. The court drew favorable inference on finding the explanatory notes annexed to the consent form. That means everything was put on paper, annexed, and it was attached to the consent form. So court has basically given decision in favor of the hospital and doctor. In the second case, the patient approached the orthopedic surgeon with problem of giant cell tumor of the bone on the right hand, lower end of the radius. Orthopedic surgeon performed surgery to remove the tumor and bone graft is taken from the fibula. Later on, post-discharge patient developed the foot drop. Then they accused the doctor of negligence, but court found that the signature of the patient's wife appeared just below the disputed sentence and rejected the allegation. That means even this foot drop, the possibility of complication of foot drop was explained to the patient and the sign was taken. So it was basically rejected. Court rejected the allegation. Then one more thing, one person, one pen, one sitting, an unusual advice for filing the consent form. This is all from the court. It is advisable that documents such as consent forms are filed by one doctor or nurse in one sitting and without changing the pen. Though counseling the patient may take more than one sitting, at times changing pen while filling the consent form or changing the person who is filling the consent form give an impression of manipulation to the court and hence must be avoided. There are again two more cases. One case, a patient of 85-year-old man was operated for prosthetic enlargement. The surgeon first adopted the TURP method but subsequently switched over to the open surgery. The patient suffered post-surgery complication and expired the same evening. It was alleged that the patient was made to sign a blank consent form on which TURP was written later. The court paused, perused the medical record of the patient other than the consent form and found that TURP oblique open was clearly mentioned everywhere. Court found that word TURP was written by the same hand and had filled the filled the consent form. Hence, the court rejected the allegation. So this is so much important to be written in the same pen, same writing, and same person in one writing. That it can decide the court decision in favor of you or against you. In second case, the patient underwent hysterectomy and was discharged after a week. A week thereafter, in another hospital, the patient was diagnosed to be suffering from abdominal hysterectomy with left ureteric injury. Two more surgeries were performed with a span of 3 months in another hospital. It was pointed in defense that the patient and her husband have given high-risk consent to perform surgery. But the court drew adverse inference as the word high risk in the consent form were added in another end. So that is how it is so important to be filled in same sitting and same ink and same person. An illiterate patient and patient not conversant with English or illiterate person unable to sign. Keep the consent form in local language also. Check specifically whether the patient's signature is in English or not. Take extra care and caution if the patient is illiterate or does not know English. Give requisite information in the language known to the patient and that too in simple and non-medical terms. Record this fact specifically in consent. Take patient's signature or thumb impression. Take signature of the patient's relative or friends who knows English either as additional consent or witness, or of the translator if involved. Like it happens nowadays, many part of India, we have patient coming from Gulf countries as an international tourism, health tourism. Most of people in India, they do not know this Arabic, and these people, they do not understand Hindi or English. So the role of translator is very much important in this kind of situation, or of the other independent witness. Again, the first case was the patient was suffering from cauda equina syndrome and surgery of the spinal cord was performed by the orthopedic surgeon. Later on developing complications, they alleged into the court that allegation was that the patient was assured that this surgery would be done by a neurosurgeon. In defense, that the consent form signed by the patient clearly recorded that the surgery would be performed by the orthopedic surgeon. The court rejected the patient allegation, observing that the consent was given by the complainant patient himself in writing by putting his signature in English. In second case, the gynecologist performed the hysterectomy after taking consent of the patient and her husband. Patient denied that her husband had signed on the consent form. The patient also alleged that the Bengali version of the consent form on the reverse side of the consent form was written by another person. The court therefore referred the consent form to the handwriting expert, who confirmed that a signature on both the Bengali as well as English version of the consent was given by the same person. Then gynecologist said that this patient, they also know English well and they have signed in English. So it is not a case of negligence in any manner, because the consent was given. The court took the cognizance of the fact and they basically gave relief to the doctors. Then high-risk consent. Take high-risk consent in appropriate cases. Record the prognosis and the associated risk. Record this fact in medical record also. So in case of high risk or possible complication, you should always mention these things in medical record as well as in the consent form. In first case, the patient underwent open cholecystectomy and was discharged. Then the patient was readmitted, her condition became serious and she was shifted to ICU and underwent another surgery. Later shifted to another hospital where she expired. The cause of death was shown to be a septicemic shock. It was alleged that the patient died due to negligence in performing this surgery and handling post-surgery complications. Whereas hospital pointed in defense that the patient had died due to heart problem and not due to surgery as alleged. During the pre-anesthesia checkup, the patient ECG showed the anterior wall ischemia. The senior cardiologist was called, consulted, who advised the patient that if the surgery is so essential, it is to be taken as a high-risk surgery. This fact was explained to the patient and husband, and also the likely complication that could lead to permanent disability or death during the anesthesia on account of the heart condition. And thereafter, he voluntarily signed high-risk consent. The court accepted this defense and did not hold the hospital negligent. In second case, the patient was diagnosed with a large mass in the pelvis and lower abdomen. A lymphocele is diagnosed. Patient hospitalized, underwent oophorectomy and excision of the cyst. The patient died on the fourth day of the surgery. Court drew adverse inference, as it was found that although the hospital had taken the defense in the court that the patient was in high-risk patient due to previous surgery, this fact was neither explained to the patients and attendant at any point of time, nor high-risk consent was taken. So basically, case was high-risk, but it was not explained to the patient and consent was not taken regarding this. Then comes the witness or additional consent. Problematic or high-risk patient, complicated cases, unusual requests, unusual circumstances, suspicious situation, patient's orientation seems doubtful, risky interventions, emergencies, illiterate patients, patient unable to sign or put thumb impression, patient speaking or understanding another language, always take signature of the relatives, attendant on the consent, either as witness or as an additional consent, preferably of one who knows the read goes to read and write in English. Ask them to write a single sentence in their own handwriting, recording that the patient has been counseled, has understood, and has and therefore thereafter signed the consent. That means if you tell them to write at least one sentence, that proves that patient was there and it was counseled to them about the procedure and consent. In this case, the patient was rushed to the ICU of the hospital with chest pain. On third day of the hospitalization, angioplasty with the stent was attempted, but the procedure crashed and was stopped. About 3 hours later, CABG was performed, complication developed later, and the patient expired after a few days. The court found that before surgery, the patient had signed for CABG as well as angioplasty, and his wife had also signed underneath his signature on the consent form as a witness. Court viewed this as favorable to the hospital. Then general precaution or for procedure and surgeries. Before this regulation 7.16 says, before performing an operation, the physician should obtain in writing the consent from the husband or wife, parents or guardian in case of the minor, or the parent or the patient himself as the case may be. In an operation which may result in sterility, the consent of both husband and wife is needed. Even if procedure is delayed, consent always remains valid. The name of the principal consentant must be specifically disclosed to the patient and must also be recorded in the consent. In case a team of surgeon is involved, the name of the principal surgeon must be recorded, and in case of the team of anesthetist involved, the name of the principal anesthetist must be recorded. In this case, the anesthetist met the patient for the first time just 15 minutes before the operation. This is very common in freelancing practice. The anesthetist tried to insert the endotracheal tube twice but was unable to do so. The patient was put on artificial respiration, adrenal was injected, and ultimately the patient died. The court drew adverse inference after finding that the name of the anesthetist who was to administer anesthesia was not mentioned on the consent form. Though consent form was signed, the doctor himself has not signed the consent form, so it is invalid consent. Take a fresh consent with the name of the new doctor. If the doctor who has scheduled to perform the surgery, procedure or surgery, and for whom the patient has consulted is changed, take patient consent on day near to the scheduled date of procedure or surgery. Disclose and discuss and record specifically the name and take consent before and for additional alternative procedures or surgeries that are anticipated. In this case, the patient was admitted to the hospital where he underwent angiography and bypass surgery immediately thereafter. On the night of the surgery, patient was declared dead. It was alleged that the bypass surgery was conducted without the consent. The court categorically observed that taking a repeat consent after angiography was not required. The consent for angiography has relevant clause permitting bypass surgery also. So that is how it is so important to have your this possibility or second surgery or extended procedure to be disclosed to the patient beforehand. Then disclose, discuss, and record specifically in the consent the other available or acceptable alternative, their respective advantages, disadvantages, and the one preferred or suggested by you or the one selected by the patient. In this case, the patient, an NRI from London, underwent surgery and dental implant were fixed. Two options were discussed and the patient chose one of them as she could not spend 6 months in India, which was required for the other option. Post-surgery, the patient left for London where she consulted another dentist and underwent replacement of the implant and later sued the dentist for negligence. One of the defense was that the patient was duly informed about both the procedures, technique, risk was performed after taking a written consent from the patient. The court held that there was no negligence. Disclose to the patient and record in the consent of the decision that may have to be taken on the operation table or after any pre-intervention investigation. In this case, the patient, an old lady, 65 year old, had cataract in both her eyes. After dilating both the eyes, the ophthalmologist took the decision to operate upon the left eye first. The patient suffered post-surgery infection, underwent surgery at another hospital, and ultimately, her left eye was removed. The right eye was dilated first, and perhaps this gave an impression to the patient that right eye will be operative. Patient alleged that the wrong eye had been operated. The ophthalmologist stated in defense that the dilatation and slit lamp examination of both eyes were done prior to the surgery. The court accepted this defense, although this fact was recorded in the medical record. Disclosing and recording the same in the consent would have given more clarity to the patient and also helped the ophthalmologist in the legal procedure. That means this was disclosed to the patient and it was present in the medical record. But this, the same thing should be mentioned into the consent form also. Then disclose to the patient and record in consent important pre-intervention instructions that have to be followed by the patient, advisable. Disclose to the patient and record in the consent commonly occurring complication and the actions that may have to be taken. In this case, this is also very common in freelancing, and it is most dangerous practice, considered as most dangerous part of anesthesia practice. The patient was advised MRI scan. After laying on the machine, she started feeling suffocation and hence was anesthetized. The patient immediately, admittedly, had taken some light breakfast before the scan. The patient vomited and food particle went into her lungs. She was shifted to nearby hospital where she died. It was alleged that consent for MRI was inadequate as instruction for the patient to come empty stomach, and the fact that the sedation may be required for uncooperative patient was not mentioned. The court did not comment on this aspect but held the radiologist negligent for proceeding with MRI even after being informed that the patient had taken light breakfast. So this is how it is very important to give pre-operative instructions are very important. If you do not write them, court do not consider that you have not given proper instructions. And in case of mishappening, you will be responsible. Then take separate consent for each procedure or surgery if the two or more procedures surgeries are to be performed together within the same anesthesia or one immediately after the other. Consent for all procedure surgery must have a specific clause authorizing the doctor to switch over to any of the alternative procedure or surgery during the course of the procedure or surgery according to his or her judgment on situation. Like we previously mentioned that an angiography was crashed and then immediately after that, CABG was done. But they are saved because they have this clause in their consent form that if angioplasty fails, the patient might require CABG immediately after that. Then consent for all the procedures must have a specific clause. This says, check physically and personally that the consent form has been filled that too correctly and completely before performing any intervention. So make a rule that you have to check few things in the file, even if you are a professor or head of the department. If you are authorized, if you are being given to give the job of giving anesthesia in a particular operation theater and the patient is there, you have your associate consultant, you have your junior consultant, you have your SRs, you have your residents. But since you are a principal consultant, it is your duty to check few things in the file. It is very important. Please, please, please all do it. First, identification of the patient. First, identification of the patient, you have to check yourself. Second, patient investigation, relevant investigations are there or not. Consent is signed or not. You have mentioned your name in the consent form or not. The surgeon's name is not there is or not. And then later on, your team member's name. And finally, giving this file after completing of the surgery, check the file where your juniors have written the file in a complete manner. They have completed the file. They have completed the anesthesia record in a duly manner. Then this case was the patient, a girl of about 17 years, underwent appendectomy and was discharged the same evening. The very next morning, patient was again admitted with abdominal discomfort and vomiting. On the fourth day, jaundice was diagnosed. She was shifted to Government Medical College, midline exploratory laparotomy done, and ovary was removed. Post-surgery, the patient suffered from fever and jaundice, shifted to ICU, put on ventilator, and finally expired after 2 weeks. Quote, while holding the surgeon who had performed appendectomy negligent, has very aptly observed on consent, thus it is on record that the consent form at same nursing home was not filled properly and that doctor has not seen the consent form himself, which he should have seen before conducting the operation. And relapse or recurrence procedures. Disclose to the patient and record in consent specifically if a relapse or recurrence is a possibility. In this case, the patient has direct inguinal hernia for which he underwent surgery. After discharge, hernia recurred and re-surgery was suggested to him. The patient alleged that the hospital and the surgeon were negligent in performing the surgery. The court rejected this allegation, observing that recurrence of hernia is an inherent risk in such surgery and was disclosed to the patient and a consent for that is taken. Then multiple sessions or sitting. Disclose to the patient and record in consent specifically if the procedure surgery required multiple sessions or sitting. In this case, the patient's USG showed an enlarged prostate of about 500 gram. The urologist performed TUR and only a small portion of the enlarged prostate was removed. About 15 months later, the patient consulted another urologist, another ultrasound done, and this time the prostate size was 531 gram. The patient was operated by the open surgery method and the entire prostate gland was removed. Biopsy said and it showed the malignancy. The patient has alleged that the urologist never informed him the procedure has to be repeated. Although he revisited the urologist with the pain even after the procedure. Still, the urologist never told them that they required the re-procedure. In that case, court held the urologist negligent. Then multi-stage therapy or intervention. Disclose to the patient and record in consent specifically if therapy intervention is a multi-stage therapy. Intervention and each stage is independent or distinct from the other. Take specific consent for each stage for treatment or intervention. In this case, a patient is an 8.5-year-old girl who was diagnosed to be suffering from beta thalassemia. Bone marrow transplant was carried. The patient suffered complication and died on the 28th day of the transplant. The court drew positive inference in favor of the hospital as the patient parents were explained at every stage about the treatment that was being given and associated risk and consent for all was taken. Then this case take composite consent for both the procedure or surgery and re-exploration or additional intervention if anticipated. In this case, coronary angiography was performed on the patient who was 37 year old and a known case of aortic stenosis. The patient underwent aortic wall replacement surgery. Next day, the patient had a cardiac arrest, given immediate heart massage. About 2 hours later, the patient was taken for re-expression of OT. The patient died within few hours. The allegation was that the consent was given only for the first surgery. No consent was obtained for the second surgery. And that the purported second surgery was factually a re-operation, but was termed as re-exploration only to cover up the failure of the doctor to take the consent. Court refused to accept this allegation because court said when the first case was taken after the consultation, if it was a second case, it would have been taken as a consultation. But since it was taken in an emergency, it was a re-exploration really. So court basically denied the allegation. Then damage or removal of the organ. Take special care, disclose to the patient and take elaborated high-risk consent if possibility of damage or removal of an organ exists. This patient, the patient is about 36 years, was diagnosed as a case of fibroid uterus with endometriosis and was advised total abdominal hysterectomy. The gynecologist performed the total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral salpingophrectomy and adenomyosis. No consent was taken for removal of ovary and the court held that the doctor negligent. then extension or deviation or alternative. A surgeon is competent to take an on-the-spot decision to deviate from the originally or planned course if something unusual is observed inside after opening the patient. But such an extension is permissible only if extension could not have been anticipated. Extension is in the area of the original treatment or intervention or incision. Patient is not in the position to give consent. Extension necessary to save patient's life or preserve health. Postponing, delaying extension would be unreasonable and not merely uncomfortable. No indication that the patient would not have consented to the extension. Most important thing is do not deviate from the what has been consented and agreed, except for the bona fide reason, and only in the patient interest. Take fresh consent for doing so. This case, the patient, about 6-year-old, was diagnosed with temporary inguinal hernia. The patient was operated on left side and a month after discharge again advised surgery on the right side. The patient further refused to get the second surgery done, got his son discharged and took him to another hospital. The defense that although initially it was decided that the right side would be first operated, but the last minute after examining the patient, doctor has decided to operate on the left side first, was rejected by the court as there was no consent for the same was taken. Then extension, deviation or alteration. Do not attempt to perform extension without consent only because it would be beneficial to the patient or save considerable time and expense of the patient or relieve the patient from pain and suffering in future. This is a very, very well-known case in medical legal field, Samira Kohli case. This was the patient complained of a prolonged menstrual bleeding and was advised laparoscopy under general anesthesia for making an affirmative diagnosis. During the procedure, when the patient was still unconscious, consent of the patient's mother, who was waiting outside the OT, was taken. The abdominal hysterectomy and BSO was performed by the gynecologist. The patient alleged that the radical surgery was without her consent, as she intended to marry and start a family. She would have refused to consent for removal of her reproductive organ. The gynecologist stated in defense that if uterus and ovaries had not been removed, there was a likelihood of serious health problem in future. The court declared that unless the unauthorized additional or further procedure is necessary in order to save the life or preserve the health of the patient, and it would be unreasonable to delay the further procedure until the patient regains consciousness and take a decision. So in that case, it was found that doctor was on the wrong side and court held the gynecologist negligent. Then procedure with an extension with patient's oral consent if possible, or additional written consent from the patient's relative or attendant if possible, or without consent, depend on the emergency of the or urgency of the procedure. Extension, record the reason for proceeding without consent in surgery notes. In this case, the patient was diagnosed as a case of appendicitis during the surgery. Appendix was found to be normal, but a large duodenal perforation was found and closed. Post surgery, the patient's condition became worse and the patient was referred to another hospital. Duodenal fistula was diagnosed. Multiple procedures were done and the patient was discharged. Patient challenged the action performed outside the scope of consent given for appendicitis. The surgeon specifically pointed in defense that they revised the diagnosis after opening the patient, but only after consent of the patient's relative the perforation was closed. The court held that there was no negligence. Take fresh consent for any last minute change in the treatment or intervention. Failure to complete the procedure surgery, record this fact and the reason thereof in the surgery notes. Then corrective procedure or surgery. Injury mishap caused during the procedure surgery that requires corrective procedure or surgery. Close the patient, take patient's specific consent and then perform the corrective procedure or surgery, except where the corrective step would be necessary to save the patient's life or preserve the health, and it would be unreasonable to delay. The fact that unauthorized additional surgery is beneficial to the patient, or that it would save considerable time or expense to the patient, or would relieve the patient from pain or suffering in future, are not ground of defense. Be careful. Usually we are very, doctors are considered very humanly when they are doing a good job. If something goes wrong, the same thing comes as a adversity against you. Then medical termination of pregnancy. Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act 1971, no pregnancy shall be terminated except with the consent of the pregnant woman. MTP take written consent of the woman only and after proper counseling. Counsel the patient all alone at least once and specifically record this fact. This case we have already mentioned before. It is the same patient who has gone for MTP and tubal ligation with her husband and then created ruckus. In second patient, the patient had a 14-week pregnancy. Medicine for MTP were given and the patient was discharged. Next day, the patient had complication and was again hospitalized. The gynecologist performed laparotomy with the help of another surgeon after obtaining written consent. Patient expired on the third day of the surgery. The court observed that the gynecologist was negligent for not taking consent for MTP. So even MTP done with the medical means, you all have to take the consent before giving your consultation or advising them the medicine. Then sterilization procedure. In case of sterilization procedure, it is now mandatory that proper counseling is given to the couple before consent is taken. The patient must be told in no uncertain terms that there are chances of failure of the operation. This is very important. Any sterilization procedure, you have to tell patient that it will fail. Post-procedure precautions and ought to be taken by the couple, like abstaining from the sex during a specific period, use of condom, etc., must also be advised and explained. Both these facts, that is, counseling about the procedure as well as about the post-procedure complication, must be specifically recorded in the medical record. In this case, the patient has undergone tubectomy at the government hospital and conceived after 8 years and then sued the hospital. The gynecologist not only denied that any guarantee was given, but also pointed that the patient was counseled on the preventive measures that she ought to take as laid down by Director General of Health Services, Haryana. The court held that there was no negligence. Intervention where sterility is anticipated, unusual law, Regulation 7.16. Surgery procedures that may result in sterility take consent of both the husband as well as wife. In any surgery or procedure for sterility or where you anticipate sterility as a possible consequences or complication, and where the patient is a married person, man or woman, take consent of both the husband and wife. This is a mandatory provision, and interestingly, this written law is found only in India. So you have to be careful. Then delay in giving consent. Record patient's delay in giving consent for the treatment or procedure, hospitalization, or request for a specific time to start an intervention, usually for astrological reasons, in both the medical records and consent form. Record the reasons also. Record the time when consent was sought as well as the time when consent was given. Take patient's acknowledgement. In first case, the patient was admitted for delivery. Next day morning at about 8 a.m., sign of fetal distress was noticed and the gynecologist took decision to perform emergency cesarean and called an anesthetist. There was no member of the patient's family and they refused to give the consent at that time. At 10 a.m., patient's father-in-law arrived and signed the consent, but by the time anesthetist had left the hospital. He was called again, another anesthetist was arranged, and he reached around 11:15. Cesarean section was performed under spinal anesthesia. Baby was delivered. The anesthetist, but there was some complication, and anesthetist put an inpatient on intubation, later on ventilator, then shifted to another hospital. Patient was bedridden for several months and finally died after a few months. Later, when allegation of negligence were made against the anesthetist for not following the standard protocol, the fact that consent was delayed was specifically pointed in defense. So delayed consent was taken as a defense by the hospital. The court termed this delay as a contributory factor for the consequences that followed. So basically, this delayed consent, which was recorded, has actually helped the doctors. In second case, the patient underwent cesarean, her condition deteriorated, and she was referred to another hospital where she was diagnosed with acute peritonitis, post cesarean and septic shock. Exploratory laparotomy was performed, patient was shifted to ICU, put on ventilator, but died on the fourth day. One of the defense taken by the hospital was that when cesarean was advised, the patient husband refused the same and took the patient away for a second opinion. He came back after 1 hour for agreeing of this, to agree for the surgery. The delay was not taken into the account by the court by holding the hospital negligent, as it was not recorded in the consent or the medical report. So this is so important. In first case, it was recorded, so helped the doctors in hospital. In second case, it was not recorded, actually went against the doctors. In third case, the patient met with an accident, was diagnosed with acute lumbar disc prolapse, surgery was performed, and the patient was discharged. During one follow-up, the orthopedic surgeon diagnosed that the patient was suffering from spondylosis and advised the surgery immediately. But patient postponed the surgery for 2 days as an astrologer's advice. The surgery was uneventful. Later on, the patient underwent 2 more surgeries at different hospitals for the same complaint. Patient allegation that the surgery was defective was rejected by the court on the ground of delayed consent or any means. Then refusal to consent. Statement of law says every patient has right to refuse the consent treatment. Guardians of incompetent patient can exercise the right of refusal. Even prisoners or under trials have right to refuse the treatment. Do's and don'ts. Record specifically patient's refusal to give consent for a treatment, intervention, hospitalization in the medical records. Take a proper letter or endorsement from the patient refusing the treatment. Patient refusing to give consent, first try to understand the reason for refusal. Then persuade the patient to give consent, take help from the family member. Be extra alert in controversial procedures such as abortion, sterilization, psychosurgery, or where the consent of refusal could be grave or fatal. In this case, patient underwent a combined carotid endarterectomy and coronary artery bypass surgery. About 5 days later of discharge, patient was readmitted as there was discharge from the sternal wound. Plastic surgeon was called and he advised the repair with the plastic surgery. But this procedure was refused by the patient. Patient was discharged after 1.5 months. About 6 weeks later, the patient was readmitted to the hospital, developed multi-organ failure, was put on ventilator support with dialysis, and expired in the hospital about 2.5 months. The court found from the medical record that the patient had repeatedly refused to perform plastic surgery, even though advice and his fact was duly recorded. The hospital was not held negligent. Then doctors have right to withdraw from the patient who refused to give consent, specifically for life-saving intervention or treatment. This case, the patient who met with a roadside accident and have extensive injury on his right thigh with compound fracture of the left tibia and underwent surgery. About 2 weeks later, the patient's one of the limbs started becoming bluish with swelling. A senior consultant was called from the another hospital and he advised amputation, but the same was not performed. The patient expired about 3 weeks thereof. One of the defense of the hospital was that the patient's son has refused to give consent for amputation and that this was clearly recorded in the medical records. Now, lower court said, held the hospital still negligent, observing that if there was persistent resistance by the complainant, patient's son, nothing prevented the doctors or hospital to either ask the complainant to take the patient to some other hospital or to amputate the limb. But later on, in the higher court, this charges of negligence were removed. A very interesting controversy not yet settled finally is whether a Gaelic child, a child under the age of 16, an American concept who has a right to give consent also has a right to refuse it. Refusal basically requires higher level of maturity and hence there is a disagreement. This concept is not applicable in India and minors do not have a right to either give consent or refuse the consent. This right can be exercised only by their parents or guardian in Indian context. Then part of modified consent. In case the patient give part consent and refuses to give consent for other part of the treatment or procedure or surgery, contemplate whether the part of the treatment or procedure or surgery which has been consented to can be disconnected from the part that has been refused. Weigh the consequences of not performing the part that has been refused. If you foresee even a slightest problem, it is advisable not to proceed rather than proceeding. You must withdraw yourself from the treatment if the consequences of part refusal are harmful and risky. In case you decide to proceed, take elaborate consent clearly recording that only part consent has been given and part has been clearly refused. Specifically record the foresight in the medical record, take an endorsement from the patient or attendant. Then patient refuse the part best option and choose another option offered by the doctor, or patients prefer a particular option other than those offered by the doctor. Record in consent medical record that the best part is not consented and second best choice is chosen, or a choice is chosen which is basically the choice of the patient. The various options offered and the option chosen by the patient. Take endorsement from the patient or attendant. Explain to the patient and record in the consent the relative advantage and disadvantage of each options. Ensure that the option chosen preferred by the patient is acceptable to the medical science. In this case, the patient this patient, the dental surgeon extracted the 7th and 8th teeth of the patient. The allegation was that the 8th tooth was negligently removed instead of the diseased 7th tooth. And it was only when the patient informed the dental surgeon about the mistake that the 7th tooth was also removed. Dental surgeon pointed that both the teeth were infected and she had advised the removal of both the teeth. But the patient had not given this consent and requested her to remove only one. The dental surgeon therefore removed the infected 8th tooth first. But about an hour later, the patient came again complaining of severe pain in his gum and requested her to remove the 7th tooth also. Therefore, she removed the 7th tooth also. The dental surgeon was not held negligent because the patient's choice was recorded in the consent and as well as in the medical records. Then advanced directive and living wills. End of life care instructions such as advanced directive, living wills, do not resuscitate, allow natural death are not legally recognized in India. Be careful. Do not follow end of life care instructions given by the patient or their relative or attendants. Then Supreme Court rules for simple consent. Supreme Court in Samira Kohli case, we have just mentioned, where slightly aged lady who was unmarried and we went for a laparoscopy, and later on her mother's consent was taken for bilateral cervicalectomy and hysterectomy. This is the same case. The stringent informed consent is inapplicable. Consent liberalized in favor of the doctors. The American doctrine of informed consent has been made inapplicable in India, and the court have been directed to follow the liberal English doctrine of real consent by the Supreme Court in case of Amira Kohli versus Prabha Manchanda and others from April 2008. In effect, it means that consent has been liberalized in favor of the doctors. The landmark judgment has made drastic changes in the law of consent in India, and it tilts in favor of the doctors. This case was, the patient was diagnosed to be suffering from rheumatic heart disease and mitral stenosis. He was hospitalized and advised to undergo balloon mitral valvectomy. The patient underwent investigation and the date for BMV was fixed. The procedure was postponed thrice as the doctor wanted to perform it during a workshop on balloon mitral valvectomy, which was to be held in the hospital. During the procedure, patient developed complication, was rushed to the hospital, underwent an open heart surgery. The patient did not regain consciousness thereafter and died after a few days. The court held the hospital negligent only for improper consent. Although there were other allegations also, The court, while commenting on consent, observed that American concept and standard of treatment procedure and disclosure of risk, consequences and choices are not applicable. The basic difference between an informed consent and a simple consent, what I could learn and understand is that informed consent is basically quite a mechanical way of taking consent. Everything is printed and there may be 100 clause, like you sign every day whenever you even take an app, download an app on your this phone or computers. So this is kind of comparable to informed consent. And in Indian courts, this is not done. I mean, you can write down 70 terms and conditions, take a patient's signature, this is not done. Consent should be voluntary. It may be 2 lines, 3 lines, 5 lines, whatever it is required for that procedure by that patient is more important than taking a pre-filled consent form and taking a single consent. So actually this helps it in Indian scenario. If a two-liner consent by patient himself is given, is more beneficial than 10-page consent, which was controversial. So this is how the difference between informed and real consent or simple consent exists. So this is all about consents. And you find all these things suitable or good to know. I have one more topic. If you agree, I will present you that the topic would be what is medical negligence, criminal liability, and arrest of the doctors. If you show your eagerness to know about it, well, in next few days or 15 days or 20 days, we can present this one also. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Hetal. Thank you, TAS.
Thank you, sir. A few questions are there. Can you please stop sharing the screen? Yes, sir. So there is a question from Surendranath. So in any case, if there is a re-exploration, we should take a fresh consent for procedure and NSCI. Is it right?
Yes, but see, the time is very important. If you have a defined time, you know, re-exploration is done after 2 hours. And we have not consulted with the patient. Patient has regained consciousness. We have not consulted the patient. We have not consulted the, even if the patient is unconscious in the same phase of anesthesia, she is sleeping or he is sleeping, and then we have not consulted the patient's relative. That is shown in your medical record, and that will be taken against you. But if there is no time, and actually it is a re-exploration with no time left, won't always give you a benefit of emergency. Because in emergency situation, a doctor has a right to even do any procedure without consent.
Right, sir. Another question is, sir, do we need to take separate consent for arterial line or central line like procedures we do along with anesthesia?
No, but you have to write all these procedures in your consent form beforehand. You should explain them. That your anesthesia will be will associated with this kind of procedures, like cardiac surgery is done, high end this organ transplantation surgery are done. We should always mention and explain them that there will be an arterial line, there will be an jugular line, there will be a tube. You will be having on a tube. You will be on ventilator for another 6 hours or 8 hours or so. You should explain everything. You should write it, even if it's a printed consent form. Write all these points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Ventilation may be required, arterial line will be put, IGV will be put, supply will be put. You may be having a thoracotomy tube, even if you are going for a diaphragmatic surgery, or you are going for upper abdominal surgery, where you have to explore the diaphragm, you might be having a pneumothorax. In that case, you may need to put a thoracic tube, chest tube. But then you have to mention all these things. It's better to mention and explain everything in medical record as well as in consent form.
Right, sir. Last question is, as you said, for freelancer to PAC all the time, like small procedures like DNE or MTP, surgeons just call and anesthetist goes there and anesthetize the patient. So they meet the patient at the surgery. So how to tackle this thing? Is there any way to get out of these things for freelancer,
yes,
especially?
Yes. one, two, three. One is always one. You have to check the identity of the patient in the medical record. There is no way that we all know that there are some nursing homes where you will even not find the patient admission record. But say no. First, admit the patient, show me the patient record, show me the patient identity, let patient sign, write consent if the printed consent form is not there. Tell that you are going to do the MTP. Have you consented for it? Take a signature. Take the husband's signature. Done. Printed consent form is not a necessity. It is not a necessity. It is not mandatory.
Right, sir.
So we cannot take a... Please.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
My point is that we cannot take it as a defense that because it was a small nursing home, because a doctor called me and I reached just 5 minutes before I did this procedure without the signing the consent form. And I mentioned clearly that any consent form, if it is signed by the patient and relative, if you have not countersigned it, this is invalid.
Right.
Probably we do not know how important it is to sign that consent form by you also.
Right, sir. There is a question, an elderly patient refusing for surgery, but the doctors or sons want the surgery in the best interest and request anesthesiologist not to explain the details, just biopsy and out to the patient. Is it valid?
Well, it is a controversial subject. If patient has compliant, I mean, he is a competent patient. Doing a surgery without, I mean, age is not a criteria. Once it is above the age of 18 years in India, patient is competent, you have to disclose the facts to the patient. You have to disclose.
Right, sir. And another question is, do we need to take consent for procedures like RT insertion or CSF sampling for examinations?
Yes, every procedure. Every procedure.
Right, sir. I think we are done with the questions. If anyone have any question, we can anytime discuss on the forum. So you can ask the questions and Vinit sir will answer your questions with comments. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you, Vinit sir.
Thank you all. Thank you very much. Thank you.